I think we'll start today's topic as part of this Cornea Essential series. Today, we'll try to discuss about this topic, that is dry eye. As all of you know, most of this topic, as the name suggests, could be very dry and vague, but I'll try to make it as interesting as possible. And whatever I'm going to tell in the lecture are from the guidelines of the TIFOS due to recommendations. So in the presentation, we'll cover the topic under the following headings. First, we'll try to define dry eye and try to classify it. Then we'll briefly go through the epidemiology and pathophysiology of dry eye. And then comes the most important part of diagnosing it and the four steps of management of dry eye. And finally, we'll just review some important studies that are there in the dry eye arena. So I think if you want to define dry eye, we can do it in three steps that will make it more easy. So first, we all have to accept the fact that dry eye is a multifactorial disease of the ocular surface. And it is characterized by two things. One, it is a loss of homeostasis or tear film or an unstable tear film plus ocular symptoms. So it should be characterized by an unstable tear film and ocular symptoms. So in which these could be caused by, again, three things. It could be hyperosmolarity or inflammation of the ocular surface or any neurosensory abnormalities. So if you see, now again, I'll try to repeat it so that it becomes easy for you to define. First, dry eye is a multifactorial disease of the ocular surface. It is characterized by two things, an unstable tear film and ocular symptoms. And the causes could be hyperosmolarity, surface inflammation, or neurosensory abnormalities. So this is how you can easily define a dry eye. So when it comes to causes, it is common sense. It could be only two causes. One is you are not producing sufficient tears, or the tears which you are producing are getting evaporated faster than normal. And most commonly, what we see in our day-to-day practice is an evaporative kind of dry eye. So in aqueous deficient dry eye, it is a lacrimal gland function that is being affected. Whereas in an evaporative kind of dry eye, it is more lid-related, like meibomian gland diseases or blink-related or surface mucin or contact lens-related, things like that. We'll discuss about these things in detail as we go further. So if you see the pathophysiology, don't be intimidated by this very busy thing. Just concentrate on the outer circle. So if you see outside the aqueous deficient dry eye, so these are all the possible causes you can have. One is the aging, lowering of androgens by age, autoimmune causes, lacrimal obstructions, systemic drugs, reflex box that is caused by a refractive surgery, contact lens wear or anesthesia. So all these form the aqueous deficient dry eye component. Whereas the evaporative dry eye, the most common thing is meibomian gland disease, followed by other lid conditions like blepharitis and a deficient or unstable lipid layer, deficiency of caused by ocular allergy or contact lens. So finally, whatever happens, it all turns down into this tear hyperosmolarity. That is why it has become an important part of the definition also. So if you go back and see the definition, so here the main cause becomes hyperosmolarity. Okay, so next few slides we'll discuss according to the steps. So in the coming slides, I'll try to take each of this part in an individual way, so that we can come back to this slide again in the last, so that it will make more sense to you. Right, so this I have divided for the sake of convenience into six tasks that have to be done for successful dry eye diagnosis and management. So if you want to successfully diagnose dry eye and manage it, these are the six things you have to do. And the good news is, to do these six things, you need not have any hi-fi equipment. All the basic equipments and common sense that you have will help you do this six easy tasks that will help you diagnose the dry eye correctly and treat them in a proper way. So first thing would be triaging questions. So these triaging questions are nothing but it is to differentiate other ocular conditions from dry eye so that you know for sure that you are going to handle a case of dry eye. Next week go to the risk factor analysis. There are so many known risk factors that can cause dry eye, so we have to analyze them. Third is a questionnaire. There are a lot of dry eye questionnaires that are available online, but I think there are two most relevant of them. One is the dry eye questionnaire and one is the OSDI, the ocular surface diagnosis index. So I think these two questionnaires we'll discuss. And next would be the tear film homeostasis markers. So these are the tear breakup time, osmolarity, surface staining. And next we have the subtype classification. The subtype classification is the final classification where you want to know whether the kind of dry eye is evaporative or aqueous deficiency. And once you know that, then you can go for a stepwise management. The most important thing here is, if you observe the fourth point, in this tear film homeostasis markers, you need not do all the three. So you can do any one of them. So I think surface staining, every one of us can do in our OPDs. Even if you don't have access to osmolarity in kind of a tear lab, you don't have a non-invasive T-BUT, still you can do surface staining. In the same way, screening questionnaires are freely available online. All you have to do is download it and spend a few minutes to fill that questionnaire. Okay. So now let us see each of these tasks in detail. So first thing is the triaging questions. So these questions, as I've told you, will help you to differentiate between dry eye and other forms of eye diseases. So then you have to see how severe is the eye discomfort. Are they having any mouth dryness or enlarged glands? So this indicates Sjogren's. How long they have been having symptoms, if it is there is a triggering event like trauma or toxicity, if they're using contact lenses, is their vision affected and does it get better when they blink? It indicates computer usage. Are these symptoms or redness much worse in one eye than another? So if it's usually uniocular, it is less likely to be dry eye. So this can be a excluding factor for us. So do your eyes itch, swell and crusty? So you're looking at some concomitant lid conditions here. So like that. And if the patient has already been diagnosed with any general health conditions, so that you know the systemic condition of the patient. Suppose the patient has collagen vascular diseases, or he had some form of steroid therapy or hormonal therapy. So all this will help you know a pretest before you go into the actual dry eye screening. So now comes to the second task. The second task is risk factors analysis. So there are two risk factors here. One is the non-modifiable and the second is the modifiable. So if you see the non-modifiable risk factors, aging, the more you age, you are more susceptible to dry eye. Females are more prone to dry eye, especially after menopause. And Asian race as such is more susceptible to dry eye when you compare with the Western population. And one more non-modifiable risk factor is a meibomian gland dysfunction. Most of you may be wondering why meibomian gland dysfunction is a non-modifiable factor. Because meibomian gland dysfunction, whatever treatments we have today, just to provide you temporary relief. They don't give you a permanent solution. So this is a chronic problem which only can be treated, but it will always recur, and some form of treatment you should have throughout the life. Next, you have connective tissue disorders, which are again systemic, and Sjogren's syndrome, which is again systemic in nature. So in these cases, you can't do much. So these are all non-modifiable risk factors. Whereas modifiable risk factors are hormone therapy, especially if there is an androgen deficiency or an estrogen replacement therapy or contact lens wear, And most commonly nowadays we see pollution, low humidity, especially there's something called as the sick building syndrome, which it is typically seen in multinational companies, where it is along with the use of computer or digital screen, it becomes even worse. And some medications which are known to decrease the tear film are antihistaminics, antidepressants, anxiolytics. So these, so you always ask the history of any use of psychiatric medications, and at the same time if they're using any antihistaminics. And iatrogenically, all the surgeries, ocular surgeries we do, and any kind of eye drops we give, to some form disturb the ocular surface, and they form a modifiable risk factor for dry eye. So now that task one and two are over, now we are going to task three. So in task three, I told you, you have two questionnaires. One is the dry eye questionnaire and one is the OSDI questionnaire. So dry eye questionnaire basically takes three questions, that is eye on eye discomfort, eye dryness, and watery eyes. So according to the scoring here, you get here, and if the score is equal to or more than six, it is a positive test. In the same way, in OSDI, it is more comprehensive and time-taking. So I think for practical purposes, DEQ is more useful. So all of you can start off with DEQ, and when you get comfortable with DEQ, probably in an institutional kind of scenario where you want to do some studies and all, probably OSDI will be of more value. So OSDI also again has several questions. And in this, the score, if the score is equal to or more than 13, it's a positive score. So either if you have a score of 6 in DEQ or 13 in OSDI, it means the patient is having symptoms. So both these questionnaires are basically to know the extent of patient symptoms. So if you go back to the definition, ocular symptoms also form a very important part here. So that importance is taken care by these two questionnaires, the DEQ questionnaire or OSDI questionnaire. So I think you can start off with the DEQI questionnaire and start documenting what is the score of the patient's symptoms. So if the score is more than six, it is definitely having a diagnostic value. Now let us go to the next task. Next task, I have told you there will be three tests in this. You can do either any one of these tests. If you have access, you can do all the three. The three tests would be tear film breakup time, tear film osmolarity, and conjunctival staining. So we'll go step by step. So in tear breakup time, most commonly of what all of us do is the invasive tear breakup time that we do with the fluorescein. But invasive fluorescein breakup time is not very reliable according to the recent studies. So automated non-invasive shows superior discriminatory ability in detecting dry eye according to a JAMA publication in 2018. So if you have access to image that can give you a non-invasive tear butt, that should be the ideal way of looking at tear breakup time. So any tear breakup time that is less than 10 seconds is a positive thing for diagnosis. Because in the invasive, what happens is the fluorescein itself will cause some instability to the tear film. So that is the reason we prefer non-invasive tear breakup time. Next is the tear film osmolarity. So this is one of the recent advances that has come into the picture. So as you can see here, this is how it looks, and this is the test card with a chip technology in the tip. So what happens is you can test the osmolarity value. So any value of more than 308 is considered to be of positive diagnostic value, and any inter-eye difference of more than 8 again is considered to have a positive diagnostic value. The only problem with this test is that right now it is not available everywhere, and it is also expensive. It almost costs around 2000 rupees to take a test from both the eyes. And the third most simple and practical thing all of us can do in our OPDs are simple fluorescein and lissamine green staining. So all you have to do is stain the cornea with fluorescein and then stain the conjunctiva and lid margin with lissamine green. If you have more than 5 corneal dry spots, or if you have more than 9 conjunctival dry spots, or if you have the lid margin that is taking up the dye of more than 2 millimeters or covering the breadth of 25%. So these are all the telltale signs of an ocular surface damage. So I think straight away from the time this lockdown is over, we can all practice this simple staining methods to know the tear film homeostasis on the ocular surface. So the diagnostic criteria would be fluorescein staining for cornea and lissamine green staining for conjunctiva and lid margin. So more than 5 corneal spots, more than 9 conjunctival spots, and lid margin with more than 2 millimeter involvement and width of 25% involvement will have a diagnostic value in diagnosing the tear film homeostasis change. So last one would be, now that you have known symptoms are there, then you have gone and seen the tear film instability is also documented in some form. Now you want to know which type of problem the patient has. So first let us see the aqueous deficiency. So to see the aqueous deficiency, there is only a very simple test again that we can do in our slit lamp. That is the tear meniscus height. So if you have a slit lamp with 40x magnification and a graticule, you can all measure the tear film height. So once you measure the tear film height, and if the tear film height is less than 0.2, then the aqueous deficiency severity starts grading from there. And I think in the recent optical coherence tomographers also, we have a module that measures this tear meniscus height. And as I have told you, the tear meniscus height and aqueous deficiency, we may not be doing it so commonly because aqueous deficiency dry eye is not that common. Next, we'll go to the evaporative dry eye, which is more common. Again, here, if you can do it under slit lamp, what you need to do is try to see the meibomian glands and try to express the glands on slit lamp to see for its patency. If you have an access to meibomography, that is very good because you can also see how the glands are inside the lids. And at the same time, try to look for other things like blink mechanism and lid closure. So I think now we have completed the tasks here. And the final task would be on the management side. So management, the TIFOS recommends 4 steps management. So what you have to do is, first, if the patient has very mild symptoms, you try to educate the patient and ask him for an environmental modification. Start off the patient with simple lubricants, lid hygiene, and warm compresses. If the patient does not respond to this, then we have to go for preservative-free lubricants or gel-based lubricants with nighttime ointment application. And you can also plan for temporary punctal occlusions in such cases. Here, with respect to meibomian gland disease, there are 2 options that are available for in place of warm compresses. That is, one is a lippy flow, that is an automated heating system which expresses out the meibom from the lids. And second one is the intense pulse light therapy, which stimulates the glands and increases the flow of the meibom. So apart from this, if the cases are moderate, you can use pulsed steroid therapy with cyclosporine and oral doxycycline. If the patients are still not responding to this, then you can think of oral secretagogues like oral acetylcysteine or pilocarpine, and then you can think about autologous serum eye drops, especially if there is a neurotrophic component involved, then you can place a BCL or scleral contact lens. And in terminal cases, I think we have to use steroids for a longer period. If required, you have to reconstruct the ocular surface or the lid margin with a mucous membrane graft or an amniotic membrane graft. You should probably go for a tarsorrhaphy and also plan for a permanent punctal occlusion. Now that we have finished all the tasks, let us summarize and go back to this beautiful chart. So first, the triaging questions are done. So we know whether this condition is a dry eye or not. Once you know this is a dry eye, you assess for the risk factors in that modifiable and non-modifiable. Then you go into the symptomology. Symptomology is based on DEQ or OSDI questionnaires. So in DEQ 5, the questionnaire 5, if more than 6 or OSDI more than 13, then you have to have any one of these tests. So that I have already told you, non-invasive would be the best. Tear breakup time of more than 10 seconds and osmolarity of more than 308 or intraocular difference of more than 8. In the same way, ocular surface staining more than 5 corneal spots, more than 9 conjunctival spots, and lid margin that's having 2 mm involvement or 25%. So now, if you have a score of this plus this, you have done your screening and homeostatic marker diagnosis. Now we'll go and do the subtype classification test. Here again, in the evaporative form, all you need to do is a proper slit lamp examination to look at the lids and see the meibomian glands. And after that, you need to see the aqueous deficiency by searing at the tear meniscus height. So according to this grading, the steps of treatment that I have already told you in the previous slide. So just go back and see the 6 tasks again so that you can remember it better. The first would be the triaging questions. Second would be the risk factor analysis. Third would be the diagnosis using a DEQ or an OSDI. And fourth would be either of these, either tear breakup time, preferably non-invasive, or tear film osmolarity, or ocular surface tanning, which is the most useful and practical one. Then you have the classification based on tear meniscus height or meibomian gland examination. So I think that finishes the part of this thing. Just for completion's sake, I'll just, whatever I have told you so far is from the guidelines of TIFOS due to guidelines. Now this is the Asian Dry Eye Society study. This is also more or less similar. They also contribute the central point to be the unstable tear film, but they classify it into static risk factors like abnormality of the layers and dynamic risk factors like conjunctival, or these are all the external things. So what they recommend is targeted therapy. Suppose there is a problem with the lipid, you know, it's mostly because of the MGD. So what they ask you to do here is warm compressors, lid hygiene, low dose ointments and things like that. When it is an aqueous or mucus layer, then they ask you to go for punctal plugs, artificial tears, and like so sodium hyaluronate and ribamide also that has recently come for mucin problems. And when it's an epithelial problem, again, they prefer to give autologous serum and ribamide. And if the surface inflammation part, you always have low dose steroids, cyclosporin or ribamide. So this is how the Asian Dry Eye Society takes a different approach. But finally, when you're treating, it's more or less the same. TIFOS is more systematic, as we have seen. It is easy to approach the patient both in diagnosis and management. So I think that finishes this talk.